Welcome back. This is Chapter 1, which is an introduction to managerial accounting. You have to take two courses, financial accounting and managerial accounting. Financial accounting is intended for all users, both inside the company and outside the company. Primarily, the users inside the company are managers who have to make decisions. A lot of the information that managers use to make decisions would not be something a company would want to provide to outsiders, such as stockholders, creditors, competitors, government agencies, or customers, such as how much is the gross profit on one bottle of Dasani water. Coca-Cola would not like Pepsi to know that information. Because you have a pretty good understanding of financial accounting and how the financial statements are generated, we're now going to look at that information and break it down into smaller quantities, more detail. Managers will use this to plan and control operations. In fact, planning and controlling are the two main components of managerial accounting. Let's first compare financial to managerial accounting. In comparing the two, managerial accounting is a lot more flexible. There's no requirements that you have to meet GAAP. It's used only internally. It's not given to outsiders, so you don't have to worry about the Securities and Exchange Commission, the Internal Revenue Service, or does it comply with accounting principles. It's also forward-looking, meaning it's a planning tool for the future. Financial accounting was based on transactions that already had occurred. When we look at managerial accounting, we'll be looking at what-if or pro forma financial statements. If we make this change, what will the financials look like? Managerial accounting is also more timely. Being more timely, we may sacrifice some accuracy. It also emphasizes parts of a company, such as a segment or a product, rather than the company as a whole. In addition, it looks at and examines both quantitative, which are the numerical dollar amounts, and qualitative considerations. Qualitative considerations are those touchy-feely things. How does it impact customers? How does it impact employees? The primary goal of managerial accounting is to provide information for internal decision-making. Again, it's for the internal decision-making aspects of our company. There are two tools that accountants use to achieve this: controlling and planning. We're going to start with planning because before you can control, you have to go through the planning process. Planning is a managerial accounting tool, and it's the way managers communicate with its employees or its lower level managers. It communicates the company's ultimate goals. It helps managers make decisions. In fact, financial plans in themselves are called budgets. And I know, being a college student, you have had to budget something in your life, whether it be how much money you're going to be spending on meals each week, how you're going to use your financial aid check to pay for living expenses as well as tuition and textbooks. It also helps identify the sources and the uses of the resources. Recall that resources of a company are also known as assets. Controlling is another managerial accounting tool. It's used to measure performance. We compare the performance, which is the actual activity, with the budgeted amounts, and then we look at the differences. And often we have to take action. The kind of performance that we measure is the performance of a manager or the performance of a unit as a whole, such as a product, a division, or a segment. Take, for example, the Jacksonville Jaguars this season. Del Rio, the coach, is no longer around. Was it because he had a bad performance as a manager? Or was it because the whole team was just pitiful? So the performance can be gauged on different factors within a company. Technology has a big impact on management decisions. Let's talk about the value chain. The value chain includes all the activities of a company, starting with the acquisition of materials, the operations or the production of products and services, selling and marketing these products to customers, getting them delivered, providing service, warranties, maintenance, and all the other related support activities that might go along with this, such as administration, human resources, research and development, payroll, and everything else a company must include in order to start from the beginning, generate a product, and get to the end. Over the last 10 or 15 years, there has been a big shift from labor to machinery. Companies are acquiring machines that can actually do the work that laborers were doing in the past. A company gets rid of its laborers and it converts to machinery. If you have a company and it has a whole bunch of employees and you need to downsize, you lay off some employees. If you have a company with a whole bunch of machinery and you need to downsize, it takes quite a while to uninstall the machinery, put it up for sale, and actually turn that machine into cash. That makes a company more risky if it's holding more machinery. Machinery including all the property, plant, and equipment assets. This concludes Chapter 1. You will look at Chapters 2 and 3 next class period.